Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the ASUS ROG Summer 2015 Hearthstone Tournament. I'm Monk, joining with me is Savitz, and for our second semifinal of the day, we have Orange. Orange, I know you've been watching a lot of the games today. How have you been doing, and how have you been enjoying the games?
I've been enjoying the games. I think we had some really good matches so far. A lot of people are doing really interesting things. We saw Tyze with the control paladin, which we haven't seen in a while. Both Tom and Oskar brought Rogue that we haven't seen much so far in this tournament. And Freeze Mage, which was like the most popular deck on day one after Hunter, I think. Mm-hmm. On day one, it's like, I don't think there's a single Freeze Mage deck in the top 8.
Yeah, nobody's playing it anymore. What happened?
Yeah, I have no idea. Yeah. I guess that they expected other people to expect Freeze Mage and they didn't want to bring it themselves.
Could also be the fact that Druid has been extremely popular in this tournament. It seems like almost everyone has been bringing it. So even if you ban out the Warrior, there's still the Druid as a threat.
Yeah, we were talking to Oskaka right before this match. We asked him, why didn't you bring Freeze Mage, which is his favorite class and his favorite deck? And he told us basically that everyone was bringing Druid in the round of 8.
And also Hybrid Hunter.
Yeah. And those are two of the most favorable matchups against Freeze Mage. So even if you ban out Control Warrior or Patron Warrior, it's still not that great for that deck.
Well, that is true. Yeah. So I guess that's that. But I'm still surprised to see all those rogues. We have one for Dom in this match. I really like watching Rogue in tournaments. I think it's, like we talked about a little bit earlier, it's one of the more complex decks to play, and there's a lot of small decision making which can either make you or break you.
Yeah, Rogue plays out a lot different than the other 8 classes, which I think is what makes the deck so interesting. I know that when I've been talking to newer players that like got a good grasp of like how to play every class but Rogue, just because it's way different than anything else.
Yeah,
the class is more about like marginal advantages, rather than like having a big power turns, although that is also one of the things Rogue does pretty well.
We're seeing the lineups for both players right now. Both players, of course, did bring Hunter and Warrior. Those are kind of like the two staple decks of this tournament. Yep. Meanwhile, we have Vortex choosing Warlock and Mage, as is like two other decks, very anti-Druid. And Tom is bringing Hunter and, or rather Druid and Rogue as well.
Yeah, all three decks from Vortex Acro decks. He's playing the Zoo Warlock, the Tempo Mage, yeah, and Hunter, of course. Always with that hero power, you're kind of forced to play the face strategy.
Yeah. We haven't actually seen Vortex Hunter yet. It got banned in the first quarterfinals, if I recall correctly.
Yeah, I believe so.
It could be anything, but I would expect something like maybe more mid-range or hybrid type of thing.
Yeah,
but the face hunter wouldn't also be that bad in his lineup with those other two fast decks. He could be just going for three extremely aggressive decks.
Face hunter is slightly worse against Druid than the other versions of Hunter, which I would think that he plays hybrid or midrange because
probably,
of that reason.
Yeah.
Because if he does that, all of his decks beat up on Druid, and he creates kind of a bullying strategy where he won't allow Tom's Druid to get a single win. Yep. So I think this match will be pretty dependent on maybe even this game, like because this is probably the game where Tom's Druid has the highest chance to win.
When we interviewed Vortex right after his match, he said he basically geared his lineup against Tyze. He was completely sure that Tyze would be Druid, and it just so happens that his next opponent, Tom, is bringing Druid as well.
Exactly.
Yeah, if that Druid from Tom manages to get a win early on, it might be extremely favorable for him.
From what we can tell, that Druid is like a completely standard one. No really like big techs like Mind Control tech from Tom. Like, we saw Powder bring Mind Control tech. He did amazingly with it in the previous match. He also won against RDU with that Mind Control deck, so certainly the MVP card for him.
Yeah, absolutely.
And here we go.
Yeah, right into the game.
We're going to see what kind of Hunter it is from Vortex now. No Wild Growth, no Innervate just yet.
I think you still keep the Keeper of the Grow as the Druid here. It's just such an important card. Oh, yeah, here we see a Houndmaster, which tells us that it's more of a mid-range style of deck. Did any of you catch what Vortex had written?
Well, if you want to support Vortex and Fate to Karma, you can follow him at that address that he showed.
Wow, that's pretty rough hand from the Druid.
Yeah.
Ooh, a one drop, just a little bit late, but it's still kind of okay, because on turn 3 he will be able to play it with the Haunted Creeper.
Yeah, the Hunter hand is looking pretty amazing. Like,
oh, that oh. helps.
A terrible Druid hand just became a pretty,
yeah,
pretty decent one, I'd
say. Yeah, I changed my mind. That's good. Not quite a wild draw, but still a good draw, for sure. Those are exactly the cards that you want against this one. Okay, Tom can't wait to play that Haunted Creeper. Seems like the obvious decision to play it over the Mad Scientist just because of the Haunt Master in his hand. So if the beast is surviving, he will have the perfect play for next turn.
If you go out into Haunt Master, that's one of the that's just one of the best ways to run away with a game in this matchup. Yeah. Haunt Master prevents so much power in like one card.
Yeah.
Like a 6/5 in stats.
The trades here are not quite perfect though. If he was to play the Haunt Master, he'd still have to trade every single minion from his hand into it.
Not only that, but it's kind of an awkward health for the Druid of the Claw. He would have to throw in 7 damage into the Druid.
Okay. Well, that's a lot of stuff going to the face. Good thing about Vortex is that he does have the swipe in his hand, so that's going to be able to clean most of the board. I believe the only thing remaining after that is going to be one Mad Scientist at 1 HP.
Yeah. It will have a trap up too, which helps him slightly, but I don't think that will be quite enough. Seeing how good this swipe will be.
Yeah, that swipe is going to be amazing. There's no way he's going to do anything else here. He might be planning his next turn or... Yeah.
He might actually consider coining a hero power here for the full clear, which he probably wants to do before he swipes then.
Yeah, he doesn't have quite enough mana for that.
My bad. Well, then swipe is the absolutely the play. I'm not really sure what he's thinking about.
He could potentially attack into one of the scientists and then swipe the other scientist, because he knows that Tom only runs one type of trap, so that would kind of make one of the mad scientist death rattles to be useless. But I'd still prefer taking out the beast. Yeah, and that's what he's going to do. And there's a freezing jump. No, that force of nature is
but
going
wait,
to be pretty good.
Because we haven't seen this hunter,
oh,
right?
Oh, wow.
So we haven't seen this hunter,
oh,
so...
Oh, it's Vortex's hunter. Sorry,
yeah,
I got
exactly.
confused there. I was thinking that's Tom on the hunter.
Yeah, we're not exactly sure what traps are in
Yeah. Wow.
That snake trap is going to be amazing,
though.
That's going
to be so good if the Haunt Master, yeah. Wow. And if Tom expects it to be freezing, he just might coin out the force of nature, because he could deal with 2 freezing traps with that potentially. We made to take out the scientist and straight blood toast.
Vortex on that turn could have just played the Houndmaster.
Oh.
I'm not sure about how I feel just using the hero power. In my opinion, the matchup is a lot about just having the board under control. I guess it makes a lot of sense when he's pretty sure that the combo triggered the snake trap.
So I'm not happy to see that snake trap there. With the Druid already down to 14, I would expect him to go face. He saw one swipe already too. I don't think he can get punished for this anyhow. That minion is still taunted.
Yeah, with both Animal Companion, Unleash, and Kill Command, which is all cards that could potentially burst Tom down. I definitely like just getting free face damage there instead of trading.
Wow, that snake trap, it was so huge. This is what we were talking about there. In the past also, like with this format where you can change your deck list, Vortex might have not been playing Snake Trap in the first or second group stage, but this is the time to add it in. And because he didn't play Hunter in his quarterfinal match, that stayed hidden here, and it's likely to win him the game.
Absolutely. One of these cases where you're switching up one card in your deck may be the difference between winning and losing.
Here we go. That one's going to be freezing, so a good call there by to go with the Force of Nature. Let's see what you do. Oh wow. Is Hopper lethal? Not quite. I don't know if I'll well.
Oh, actually now you can unleash.
I would have probably not played the Animal Company. I think Bo was just fine.
Yeah, that was a bit haste, I think.
Yeah, he played it so quickly. But with the bow hero power, he could have pushed in for 6 damage. And on the following turn, Unleash Kill Command, even through a heal, would have probably been enough. Yeah. Well, he's still in an excellent spot.
Yeah, absolutely.
Not strictly a mistake, though. If he got a Harper, that would have been so good.
Basically, Tom needs an ancient warrior.
He has to, yeah.
But he has.
And he probably knows it, too. But I'm wondering, is he still dead? Because there is the Unleash the Beast as well, which is going to probably get at least two dogs. Or precisely two dogs. So that's going to be two, and from the hero power, another two, five from the kill command, and three from the bow.
That's 12
damage. Adds up to 12, yeah, and that's going to be it. That will be enough.
That looks like it.
Yeah.
So this was a really, really important win for Vortex here, because after winning with the Hunter, both Sue and Temple Mage are such amazing matchups against Druid. Yep. So
again, Vortex. Yeah. Just making like,
okay,
sure.
Okay, I don't need to count this. Okay, I don't need to write this down. Easy enough. That's snake talk. Oh man, I think that's such a good call to put it in.
Yeah. Definitely the key card for Vortex win here.
Alright.
Vortex looks more calm and collected than he did during the first quarterfinals, where we saw him look a bit stressed. He made some mistakes that were really out of character for him. It really seems that he took this break to good use and calmed down.
He seems really focused to me. I mean, I'm looking at him. Like, now it's like all business, really, zoning in the game. And I think he played that. Well, maybe the animal companion was a bit questionable there. He could also just hero power, play the bow. But not necessarily a mistake. It was a bit rushed. He didn't really think very long before he did it. So.
Yeah, in the previous match, he was not only nervous because he made a few mistakes, he was also nervous because he played Zoo three times in a row, and he didn't draw any of the Void Callers, so he actually thought that he forgot to put them in his deck. But right after, he checked his deck, and he's now completely sure of that. So he shouldn't be too nervous when he's playing Zoo now.
Yeah.
So this is the very interesting tempo mage from Vortex, which is like standard, but it includes knife jugglers.
Yeah, he has some interesting choices in there. He was playing the mechanical Yetis and
Violet Teachers even.
Violet
wow.
Teacher, yeah, Violet Teacher. That was so strange.
Really interesting.
Yeah, probably the most. Strange card in the deck. The knife jugglers are also a bit off. I guess he didn't want to put in any secrets, so I would expect that the jugglers are replacing the mad scientist. He might have been worried about something like the Kazan Mystics.
I know that there was way back in the day there was kind of a mid-range mage deck that played knife jugglers and mirror images together with Wily Teacher, and also like I think it went as far to like actually play Pyroblast, so he might have taken inspiration from that deck way back then.
Yeah.
That deck was from the first ever Legend season, I believe.
Oh. I didn't know that. That's really cool.
A little bit low on minions right now. He only has the Sorcerer's Apprentice and the Flame Waker, so if he keeps drawing spells, this might not work out so well.
To me, this looks like a game where we're trying to set up for a good Flame Waker, but this is also fine. Yeah, it is actually sets up for a good Flame Waker the next turn, where you can Flame Waker coin and use one of your one mana removal spells.
Oh yeah. The chances for that, the Sorcerer's Apprentice, the Survive are kind of high. The only way to really deal with it would be to have a quick shot.
Yeah.
And it's not there.
And if Tom uses his turn 3 to use the quick shot and not develop anything, Vortex is completely fine with that.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Has a few decisions here, but I think it might be best to just play one of the jugglers right now. Get more minions on the board.
Yeah, I think I like putting the Abusive Surgeon down too. It's a minion that potentially can kill the Sorcerer's Apprentice. It's pretty weak to what is gonna happen here with the Flame Waker coin Frostbolt.
Do you go face first with the Sorcerer's Apprentice, or does he wanna like potentially trade for it? Because it's possible that there's like double hits on that science.
Oh wow!
Well, that's That's pretty good.
I think we're fine with the Source Apprentice triggering the trap here, right?
Yeah, like Dom was the one who was playing only freezing traps, but yeah. It seems that he wants to keep it around for now. So he's going to go the base first, then probably frostbolting aside.
Okay, let's see if we get one of the two shots on the music here, and we do.
Just,
that now Vortex is in an amazing spot here.
Yeah, for sure. But one unleash the hounds can completely turn around the situation. And the bow here, not too bad. He has the trap up already, so there's gonna be some extra charges.
The thing is though, there's yet another frostbolt in Vortex's hand. So if he just frostbolts face, I don't think that's a bad play at all. Maybe even just fireball face, actually, just to get the extra 2 damage in this turn. Yeah. Huh.
I think I prefer actually just playing the Sorcerer's Apprentice. If Tom is to like bow that the next turn, that's 3 damage anyway, and you still have all the burn in hand. Also, the burn is representing more damage with the Azure Drake that was just drawn.
Pretty interesting, because he does get some extra damage for free with the caster Frostable in face right now because of the Flame Waker, so that would be 5 damage for 2 mana.
But do we expect the Flame Waker to die next turn? And even if it does, aren't we fine with that? Because it probably means he has, like, what answers are there except, like, he has to hit it with the bow and quick shot? And then if we just develop, you know, the Sorcerer's Apprentice.
Like, the 2-4 matches up really well against that bow. The bow only dealing 3 damage. And Hunter doesn't have an easy way to deal that 1 extra. Well, seems like that Frostbolt is gonna pay off, because there would be 2 juggles coming from the juggler. One of those could have potentially had hit the Flame Waker. Oh, this feels so bad. He's forced to play more minions into the Flame Waker effect.
Yeah, definitely not what you want to do. Only something simple like a ping and a flame cannon this turn is.
Okay. I guess that's fine.
You could also go for the Sorcerer's Apprentice Flame Cannon, which is a slightly more ambitious, I'd say, but it
hope for the best.
But the payoff is really huge if it actually hits 50-50 on the juggler.
And even if it hits the web spinner, I guess he would have a chance to hit that juggler twice. But this is a safer play. I can't blame him for it. He's pretty far ahead, so he doesn't have to be too worried about just taking avoiding unnecessary risk.
Yeah.
100 down to 16, and he has Fireball on his hand.
Dragaltor Tiger. One of my favorite cards at the moment. I think that card is really good. It, of course, came from a web spinner, but it looks really, really good here.
It's so interesting, because that card has been around forever, and now it's just suddenly gaining more popularity.
Yeah.
Garcilla would be pretty nice.
Oh, indeed.
Not exactly that, okay. That's not Garzilla.
Really close.
Yeah, I'm almost there. I'm almost Garzilla.
And I think this is Tom realizing that I actually has to do the trade here with the Mechanical Yeti, which is so painful.
It is. He can hope to get +1 toughness or a cloak field on that, but even if he gets a cloak field, it's like he knows that there's a
Flame Waker.
Flame Waker, yes. So, it's not that great. Just gonna go up the base.
It's actually a lot of pressure on the board right now.
It is quite a bit, and I think that's his best chance to win. Noticing that the mage has 6 cards in his hand, so there's no way he can win a value game. I think that's a really good call from Tom too.
There's a card I did not expect at all.
Yeah,
wow.
It kind of makes sense with such a minion heavy deck. Like he has Violet Teacher, he has Knife Jugglers, which is a lot more minions than you typically expect from an Echo Mage, or rather from a Tempo Mage.
Oh yeah, a synergy that I hadn't realized is if you play Knife Juggler, Mirror Image, and then Echo Medivh, you can go off with actual Mirror Image tokens you make from Echo and have double Juggler.
This isn't the first time I've seen Echo of Medivh in Tempo Mage either. I believe Strifecrow used it in Archon Team League recently. Yeah.
Right. But we see Vortex all of a sudden. He realizes that Tom doesn't have any cards in hand, and that he can, after being like really, really aggressive by frostbolting face early in the game, he realizes that I can actually take a different approach to this game now and grind Tom out.
Yeah, he's getting dangerous as well. That Houndmaster, it's not the worst thing that Tom could have drawn, but it's not quite high main either. Mad Scientist, with his Death Rattle currently useless because there's no secrets left in Tom's deck. Flamewaker Portal, but do you trade first? Because it seems like you have to trade for the Houndmaster anyway, and you can't hit it three times, so I suppose you just try to snipe that Mad Scientist, even though it's only 104.
I think so too. Let's see.
Wow.
Oh no, it hits two to the face instead.
Now this is gonna be a close one. What does he draw?
Oh my god.
Wow. Oh, is Vortex gonna deal with it? Not happy, shaking his head.
I mean straight from the top.
Yeah. There's a lot of things that would have been bad for him, like another bow, like many setups for
later. Any direct damage, like a quick shot would have been devastating.
So Arcane Intellect into maybe Frostbolt? Is there one? No, he may.
Two Frostbolts are gone.
Yeah, he played both of them already. So is there anything?
Mirror image,
yeah.
Arcane Missile is potential?
I don't think it's gonna. No way.
He just can't survive here, right?
Some kind of chance, but I don't think so.
Oh. After seeing Vortex such a commanding lead in the...
Okay, well he does survive.
Oh, he
amazingly,
does.
With those almost missiles hitting, wow!
Oh no!
But there's the killer command. But a nice effort from Vortex.
Yeah,
a little
anticlimactic there.
Yeah. But that was a really nice try, and he got a little bit lucky with those arcane missiles, giving him another chance, but well done there, at least giving himself an opportunity. To steal that one, in case there was no damage from the top.
As we said, it looked like Tom got really, really lucky in that game, but it was so many cards that were good for him to draw there. The deck is actually just designed in that sort of way. It's gonna place out more of an aggressive hunter than most midrange decks, because you play Leopard Gnomes and double quickshot and double kill command. So it plays a lot of burn too, while still being, you know, a midrange style of deck.
Even though like Vortex got a really good Flamewaker off, the problem really there was that Tom was able to draw out the game in order for him to get the synergy with two freezing traps plus his bow. So that bow actually did, over the course of four turns, 12 damage.
Wow.
Yeah.
So much value in it. I don't know what to think of this.
Prep is a key card in most aggressive matchups, but... Then again, with prep, you actually need something to go with it.
Oh my god. Okay, that's pretty big.
I mean, Sap answers that pretty efficiently, but...
Yeah. It's not like the greatest thing ever, but it could have been way worse.
It would just be like great later stages of the game too. Like, if you place that on 4, it gets sapped, and you just replace it on 7.
Mm-hmm. You just Flamewaker here?
I think so.
There's
think
a fair chance that it would even survive. I mean, there are things that would deal with. For example, backstep into a... into Assa Agent or... Oh, okay. let's see.
I think what he's afraid of is deadly poison and eviscerate.
Gets to keep it.
There's a lot of spells in this deck. I mean,
yeah,
it is mage after all.
It's probably more likely for him to get to keep it than it would have been a beast.
If it would have actually played a Flame Waker, it would have happened, the deadly poison and eviscerate.
Yeah, this worked out way better for him.
Yeah. The hero expect just a... Garden of Kings to come down.
Probably. What were his options?
Forced him to have Sap.
Yeah, Tom, we saw in a previous game that Tom actually runs two Violet Teachers. If he drew either of those instead of the other 4-drop, which is the Pilot Shredder, that would be just amazing with the prep, double prep in his hand.
Guardian of Kings Battlecry getting wasted about 5-6. I mean, how do you pass up? And none of the other plays come even close to it in power still.
It's a Hungry Dragon without downside.
Yeah. No Boulder Fist Ogre, though.
Nope.
I'll take it.
Tom can't wait to sap that one.
One of the faster turns we've seen so far in this top 8.
Yeah.
If the game drags long, that might still get played again, and the heal might also be useful later on. And here... Flame Waker in the Frostbolt, but does the Flame Waker effort go off before the Death Rattle happens? Like, I think the Death Rattle goes first, right?
Yeah.
So he gets the minion, and where do those land?
Oh.
Just one. Sorcerer's Apprentice is such
That's so amazing in Rogue.
Yeah.
But there's only one card that's kind of benefits from it right now. So it's not that useful right now, but he could have had something like a sprint. Imagine the sprint. Pointing the sprint.
A sprinter would be absolutely ridiculous. So as Tom here, what do you do this turn? This is actually...
He has to overkill that a little bit.
Yeah, he does, right? But then again, you don't really want to use the dagger because then you have nothing to go with your Blade Flurry in hand. So I'm thinking if...
He's going all in,
yeah.
Oh, here we go. I like this line.
Yeah.
I really like what Tom is doing here.
You've already seen this one Flamemaker. It's unlikely for him to have two, and there's not really too many other AoEs in the deck besides like an Arcane Missiles, which
is unreliable.
And
that board, if it doesn't get cleared this turn, he has to load up to follow it up, so it's only going to get more difficult to clear it after.
And the only really efficient answer to a board like this would be the Flamewaker that he just killed, so you force your opponent to have the second Flamewaker.
Actually, this is a pretty efficient response.
Yeah, that's pretty good. That is quite alright. Only leaving up the 1/1s. But those are going to chip in for quite a bit. And with the cards that he had, I think that was still like by far the best move that he could have made.
Absolutely. Lofip here lets him keep up the pressure, but here's where the turn 7 Garden of Seasons might come into play and be real amazing, but it's also a really good body for contesting the Lofip as a 5/6.
Yeah, it's perfect.
Yeah, Tom actually knows that Vortex does have a Guardian of Kings in his hand, so he could plan around that right now.
Oh. Keeping the weapon. I don't know if he wants to go face with the weapon. I guess,
If you expect Guardian of Kings, you can go face, because you'll be able to dagger up next turn. Like, your dagger won't be useful.
It might be. I mean, he might pick up something like a sprint, but it might just be one missed damage. It kind of depends. It's just, like, trying to guess what his top deck is going to be.
I think it's worth it. You kind of need to draw something next turn anyway, and, if you are banking on drawing something next turn, keeping up the dagger is probably correct.
Blade Flurry is
not the card
not
he was
what
looking
wanted
for.
Here.
And now he also
go face.
Yeah.
Get aggressive. That Garden of Kings.
Yeah. So good. He can even get more of those with the Echo. it's probably not the time for it, but in theory he could. Just play everything. Well, that's gonna be amazing.
Actually, you can echo here.
No, we can?
Yes.
Oh yeah, even with the Mana Worm. Oh my goodness, that's pretty good. Yeah. Play the Mana Worm, play the Apprentice, echo for 3 mana. That's amazing.
I really like killing the Teacher here, since we're getting another Garden of Kings anyway. But I can see the reasoning behind killing Lofip too.
Not too bad. That echo. Wow. What a turn.
I have one of them.
What Tom needs right now is a Deadly Poison or the oil to get that clear.
A sprint.
Oh,
that's the oil.
Wow.
He's gonna get 2 1/1s out of his two. Here we go. This game is not over. If that draw was something else, it was something small, something slow.
Maybe. Yeah, now.
Wow, down to 5 HP. That oil was so huge. Not only did he get the full clear, it was also 8 damage to face.
Yes.
Arcane Missiles.
Arcane Missiles might be exactly what Vortex needs.
Yeah, he can play it for 0 with the Apprentice, or he can play the Mana Worm. Okay, let's see. Okay, decent.
Not bad.
Yeah. But he's still very low. They're looking at 6 damage right now. Blood Mage. You play the cycle for sure.
What's so scary for Vortex here is that you know that the Tom, he's pressuring you and it still has 2 sprints in his deck that will like close out the game right away.
But
if
all
it
he needs
ever
is an Eviscerate. All Tom needs is 1 Eviscerate.
Yeah.
But this is going to be crazy.
We're gonna do a lot of things this turn.
So he can go Juggler, Teacher, Apprentice, Mirror Image. No, how many minions?
Yeah, you just get too many minions
if
you do
that. Yeah, it's too much.
Let's see.
So can he somehow leave the card draw alive and force him? Oh, this is so good. He could kill only the teacher and play the mirror image. No juggler. Because like he doesn't want Tom to draw. So he could have potentially just kill off the teacher, leave him with the 3-1-1s and play the mirror images.
Oh yeah.
There's the card draw going. Okay.
I really like that light that you suggested there.
That actually is pretty amazing.
Everyone gets one. Yeah. One sad mirror image.
I mean, it sounds so weird not to juggle, but like denying the draw, it might have given him that one extra turn. Now it's very likely for Tom to find the damage. Well, let's see what he got. If he doesn't find it, I mean, he's gonna lose.
Oh wow.
Well, leaving up the Blood Mage would not have been so great, I guess. That fan of knife is so huge.
And there's the sprint too, which is very likely to draw him into it.
No lethal just yet, so that... Wow, there's how many... It's 11 damage on the board right now.
12 with the ping.
12 with the ping.
How many times have this game is this is swung so back crazy. And forth?
Yeah.
This is just crazy.
Do we know what the last card is in Vortex's hand?
It was a...
Break?
Yeah, I think it was Drake.
Yeah, okay. It's actually Drake.
Yeah, any spell would add one damage, so he would need like two spells here.
That maneuver, but he cannot take it out. He has to go face here, otherwise he might not find the lethal for next turn. But if he was to kill it out, he could also... No, you gotta go face, and just hope for the best. It doesn't improve his odds that much to kill the maneuver right now.
Here we go.
He is going to try with that line.
I think the sprint is save him so from, likely to draw into lethal.
Yeah. Killing the mana worm does save him from things like mirror image into like arcane intellect into mirror image
and
stuff.
Oh my god.
Well that actually was actually the correct
decision. Been?
Yeah,
oh,
it would have been exactly
dead.
Lethal.
Yeah, it would have been exactly lethal if he didn't kill the mana worm. Wow, well played. I'm ready to lose. But now the sprint is gonna come down and there's still still eviscerates left in the deck.
Eviscerate doesn't actually do it, though.
It's not
lethal. It's one off.
Yeah.
That's true. He doesn't have a spell power
anymore.
Yeah,
and not only that, Blade Flurries are completely gone. Two Blade Flurries have been used, correct?
And both preps, so he can't draw into double
Eviscerate
or something. Oh my god.
Yeah, so with both... What can he even get
with both preps and both Flurries out of the deck, I don't think there's anything Tom can draw here.
No, there's no preps.
Both
there's nothing. That's gonna be it.
That's
what a
game.
Wow.
Oh my god, that was one of the crazier games I've seen in a really long time. Like every single turn the game just swung back and forth.
It was so well played by both players too.
Yeah, I think both of them played that game like almost perfectly.
Yeah, amazing. Just amazing.
Yeah, I really like how in the top four we have all these really interesting decks. Like Tempo Mage versus Rogue, not a matchup you really tend to see very often.
Yeah.
That's so interesting there, like killing the mana worm. Okay, he would have died to those spells, but also he was now lacking that one damage to finish him off. So, it's so interesting with this. I really like watching that Tempo Mage in action.
And now you just have to get a win with Sue against either Rogue or Druid.
Yeah.
Druid is definitely the easier deck out of the two to get a win against, but actually, So back in the day, Rogue used to have an amazing matchup against Sue, but Sue has evolved like in the last couple of months and become more of like a deck that now it runs Dr. Boom, Mal'Ganis and stuff that can actually be really problematic for
That's
Sue.
That's true.
Dr. Boom especially.
Yeah,
Dr. Boom has always been a problematic card for Oil Rogue.
Yeah, not only that, I feel that more Zoos these days are adding Lothab into their deck, so that's two cards that are especially good against Rogue.
Absolutely. Almost every single deck nowadays runs Lothab, I would say, in the Zoo.
Yeah, back in the day, Sue was just a deck full of Knife Jugglers, Direwolf Alphas, not very sticky minions, and cards like Backstab and SA Agent on 3 were almost unbeatable.
Double Direwolves and stuff like that instead of it. And topping the curve out as Doomguard, like everything being cheaper than that.
A lot of stuff has happened since then,
for sure.
In Blackrock, Mountain Zoo is 64% against Druid and 55% against Rogue. So definitely very favorable against both these decks.
Yeah. Oh, that's gonna get punished by the implosion.
Yeah.
And there's no swipe in hand for for Tom either.
Yeah, the problem is all the other choices are risky as well.
Wrath wasn't risky. I mean, Knifejugger is such a huge threat. I probably wouldn't lean towards it, even though...
Oh!
What?
Oh.
How? Do
that is insane.
Oh.
Well, that's esports for you.
Yes, I don't even know what to say.
That's incredible.
That and Doomsayer are the only two drops.
Well, Unstable Ghoul as well.
Unstable Ghoul.
Unstable Ghoul would actually have been worse.
Yeah, because you don't get to push for free. Let's just say that all three of those are completely devastating here. And
he didn't need to
I think if Tom didn't get one of those free, his tournament run would just be over right there.
I think so too. Like, without the swipe in hand, how would he be been able to clear that?
That said, this game is far from over.
It is.
Vortex still has a lot of stuff in hand to work with.
Anything can happen. So much powerful minions in there. If he only has the time to play all those. If there's no big... Was there a big game hunter in...
There is a big game hunter in Tom's hand, which... Certainly gonna play a big role in this game.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a really good fire drop to pick up too.
Yeah. Do you charge into that? Probably just taunting up. But it's a bit dangerous with power overwhelming.
I like taunt and possibly trade the leap gap off here because that makes power overwhelming. Power overwhelming still is a thing, but.
Oh, that's.
What does that do?
I think it's good for.
I think it's good for the. Druid, I guess.
Yeah, it's good for the druid. He could have played a Voidwalker here as well.
Exactly.
Like, now he can't squeeze in the Voidwalker.
Yeah, Mana Wraith is so interesting here. It's just like, as the zoo, you don't really want to kill it off because you want your opponent to have the Mana Wraith effect on his turn. So.
Kind of free 2 damage. I mean, the Mana Wraith is going to trade anyway. I think you just go phase. Otherwise, because the Mana Wraith is going into that imp. No matter what. Like, what would be the play where the Mana Wraith is not trading in? I have no idea.
I have no idea either. To me, it just looks like 2 free face damage.
It would have to be like Keeper plus Wrath.
I'm totally fine.
I don't know.
Okay.
I'm gonna call that 2 miss damage.
Yeah, so am I. Fade and Wrath here. Not the most amazing turn, but what matters the most is that Tom is actually ahead on board. And when Druid gets ahead on board in this matchup, that's usually where they turn it around and it's starting to look really, really good.
But, he's looking at the Knife Juggler, but Dr. Boom seems quite tempting here. Even if it gets Big Game under, the Boom bots are still going to be there to potentially take out the Shade and maybe even the BGH.
Yeah, whenever I have... 7 mana and a boom in hand, I feel like I need to do a... I have to have a very good reason for not playing the Dr. Boom in my
hand. I don't think this is good enough reason not to play it.
And on the next turn, it's very likely that Vortex will be able to draw into another minion, so he can just dump his entire hand then, minus the Mal'Ganis, of course, and he'll get 3 juggles on that turn.
And even with the Big Game Hunter, the rest of his turn is going to be somewhat bad. He can clean up one boom bot first with the Shade, then the second one with the Hero Power. But he is going to be floating some mana.
It's also very likely to kill off his Shade.
That's true, that's also a problem. But what can he do about it?
Yeah, if that actually happens, if he clears both boom bots and boom bots kills off the Shade, then he plays a Big Game Hunter. The following turn from Vortex with the Knife Juggler into potentially 3 minions is very likely to juggle the Big Game Hunter, and then the Sue is ahead again.
Yeah. He has 2 Force of Nature and the Savage Ori in his hand, but even with the Wild Growing here to play the combo next turn and with the Shade on board, it wouldn't be enough. The Shade would grow up to 5, so that would be 7 from the Shade. 14 from the combo, but still that 6 damage off. He has the Big Game Hunter. It's gonna take too long.
Oh, the first one hits face. See? This is really big.
This is so
this
huge.
This is so big.
Does it kill the Shade or not?
Oh.
Oh,
it kills the Shade.
Wow, there's the Shade.
Basically the best boom bots possible here.
You want a shot? I think you do. This game is not going to go long enough that you would have time to draw cards with it. And it allows him to squeeze in that Hero Power with the Dr. Boom next turn. That first, the rest of his minions are...
not the best minion.
Let's see if he can juggle the BGH.
No. But this is important too.
Yeah, it's very relevant
that still
as well.
Helps. It still helps. In some cases, it's like, okay, well, one hit is... When you don't kill the minion, it's like same as nothing. But in this situation, it makes it so that the Beachhead will trade with the Void Walker.
So, here I would just boom and trade into the Void Walker.
Yeah, again, like, not... The reason not to boom is not good enough.
Exactly. Also sets up really well for the fourth roar.
Absolutely. Zu doesn't play a big game hunter, so the 7-7 is safe. That's so much stats for the value.
7-7 also just happens to contest Janus as well, coincidentally.
Yeah, that's true.
Thinking about force
of nature, I've based on the mouse, but
I think the...
Oh, wow.
Okay.
Okay. Interesting.
Okay, he wants to... He values the GGH. Like, the 4-1 is still pretty good. And there's not a good way for Zu to deal with that, sans, like, a second knife or a third knife juggler.
I don't... That's an interesting play. I have, like, no idea if this is any good, but it... I don't know. I don't even know how to evaluate that. This is just a... Such a shocker. Was he worried about dying, maybe?
How much power would be left on board? There would be five power left on board. He would need to have 12 damage, and a power whelming is already gone.
I wonder if Tom is actually considering like this Mel'Ganis turn. If Mel'Ganis came down on the board, Imp-Gang boss at least would be buffed.
It would.
And something like that, I suppose.
Then again, there's... Do you have a boom on board?
How do you... Yeah.
If he Mal'Ganis, he has to trade both Imp-Gang boss and Knife Jugger into the Dr. Boom. And you still have Force Roar left in hand if that happens.
The
so
Boom is still going to be good on next turn, but...
It is.
Oh.
He decides to not play Mal'Ganis there. That's interesting to me. I guess it gets punished by a lot of things, like even a Wrath would actually punish him.
I think both Wraths have actually been used already.
Oh, wow.
Whoa.
There we go.
He saw the big game hunter happen. He's just hoping here that there is no no Keeper of the Grove.
Have you seen a Keeper of the Grove used yet?
We haven't, but you know what? Vortex did this exact same move previously to get into the round of four.
It worked out that time. Yeah.
And it seems to work out this time too. I mean, at least it prevents... It makes things awkward for Tom. At the very least.
I mean, just boom shade seems pretty good. He's not in real danger of dying. There could be a Doom card powerwhelming would do it, but he just saw a powerwhelming, and I believe the other one was used earlier.
Other one was used to kill a druid on the cloud earlier.
Both of those are gone already.
A really awkward spot for Vortex.
Weird.
So there's a second force of nature out of the board, right?
Yeah, but no roar. Like, roar would be so much better. I guess it works out fine still.
Still lethal, though.
Is it lethal? With the force?
Basically, Vortex has to trade here.
Yeah. Yeah, oh yeah, absolutely. He has to trade. But after the trade, I'm trying to figure it out if he still has to lethal. It's going to be 6 damage. What was the other card in Tom's hand?
I actually don't remember.
But you know what? Tom played a Force of Nature Savage Roaring on the like 2 turns ago, and actually it's kind of working out because he keeps his BG getting so much damage.
Yeah, it's gotten a lot of value.
Yeah, the BGH that has been on board, like on every turn since it's been in play, it's been like the tiebreaker between Vortex having a great turn and like a pretty mediocre one.
Okay, so those treants. Is that connect to phase of like 4?
Oh
wow.
Every boombot this game has done 4 damage.
Yeah.
Looks like this is certainly the better matchup for the Zu of the two decks that Tom has left, so looks like he'll get away with a win here.
Boom, but the loan might just save the game.
If it follows the trend, of course.
Exactly.
Swipe, Druid of the Claw. So many things. Oh, well, that's a bad one.
The black sheep of the family.
You had one job, Boombot.
One job. Just lore here. You got me MP Robover afterwards. Draw for that lethal, maybe? Or Sylvanas. Sylvanas seems bad because of implosion.
Can you be worried at all about dying? You know.
No, not really.
No, yeah, then drawing is safe. I have a really hard time seeing these two cards. Like, seeing how these two cards do not look at the game in a couple
of there's times. Another Wrath, actually.
Oh, that's cool, yeah. Oh, that's a load of effect. I was like, oh, why didn't he brought? But, yeah, the load of effect, of course, making the spells cost 5 more mana.
absolute worst draw in the entire
top deck.
Okay.
Yeah, technically it keeps him alive if he doesn't show two. That's playing him not so good right now.
Sure, why not?
Yeah.
And
we don't have lethal.
Rats.
Rats.
Okay, this is fine as well.
Yeah. We're
okay.
Still no lethal.
Wait, Wrath.
Yeah, we're in no hurry to win. We will win this eventually. The Warlock can't hear
there's
power
no
anymore.
Way. The Mal'Ganis is already played.
Yeah.
Can't think of a card that would really turn this around anymore.
Even Deathwing wouldn't do it.
Even Deathwing.
Mom ties it up, 2-2.
Yeah, we
getting
have a game that 5.
Super important win with his druid that I actually predicted he wouldn't be able to get a single win with, but he gets it versus Zoo. We've seen surprisingly many times in this tournament that druid has been able to take out the Zoo.
Yeah.
Like definitely above average, at least based on the previous results.
Yeah, it has to do with the fact that it seems like druid every single time it gets Wall Growth, Innervate, and Keeper in this tournament. I don't know why.
And if they don't, they just casually get an explosive sheep from the Shredder.
Oh yeah, that one was...
Exactly.
Yeah.
Also, the Mono Wraith was really huge too. Like, the two Shredder drops that Tom had in that game was just insane.
Like, Vortex is gonna have so many nightmares of that explosive
sheep.
Oh
yeah.
Afterwards, if he ends up losing.
Oh, right, really good hand here from the Rogue. Especially with Edwin.
Yeah, that's pretty sweet.
Edwin's so rare these days. I don't think, like, 90% of lists don't run it anymore.
I personally am a big fan of Edwin myself in Rogue, but yeah, I've seen how a lot of people have cut back on Edwin and even Fan of Knives, which I think is, like... I'm personally not a fan of it, but I know that a lot of people do.
I think Fan of Knives is getting back in the meta, though, because... number of aggro paladins.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, it's pretty sweet.
But I think the rationale behind not including Edwin is you want more like heals, because some players they run like double healbot or double Earthrend Farseer. That's like the most standard list I find these days.
All right, let's Nerubian Egg before the Haunted Creeper. Probably playing around something like a backstab Fan of Knives.
Yeah. Not only that, you're also setting for the Defender of Argus, which can be...
That's true, too. Yeah.
Not the casual 6-6 mini.
This is one of the ways you can just run away with the game against Zoo. They usually just play one owl, and Implosion is kind of unreliable.
Point throw is not too bad. He's going to have two decent-sized minions on the board. What else could he do here?
I think Void Terror is kind of what you have to do. You could set up for Defender of Argus, I guess.
So many possibilities.
I personally would like to see the Void. I guess the Void Terror actually gets punished by a lot of things. Like if a Sap Eviscerate happens and he just hits you for 6, then you're just dead.
If you play Juggler, Coin Spider, I guess then Backstab is bad.
Yeah, Backstab SI is just devastating.
This is, I guess, the most stable play. It doesn't like necessarily lose against anything, but it's like
you don't
the
really
least reward possible.
Go anywhere with that. Like, I don't know.
Low risk, low reward.
Yeah, it's like exactly. Yeah, that's well said. Exactly like that.
Pretty sure we'll see a sap here on the Imkangos.
Yeah.
pretty good. He can't, like, facing down Edwin, he can't ever afford to replay any tempos.
Yeah, no way.
Effectively killing it for the relevant parts of the game.
Another Void Terror. Certainly not what he was hoping to draw.
I think Vortex's deck is trying to tell him something here.
Yeah, I think he got the Q, and I'm just not gonna go in. I'm going to rather.
We saw a Sap, so there is certainly some merit to actually eating both the minions here with Void Terror, which is what he's considering, I think.
How bad is Man of Knives then?
Not terrible, right?
Not that bad, just as one once. But, yeah, he's gonna eat both of them.
Again, this play has been doing fairly well for him in this tournament.
Yeah, he's going all in on Void Terror. I mean, this is not really all in, but second.
Wow, I'm like counting
Wait,
up
yeah,
how
yeah,
much
yeah,
damage
let's
can
see.
He
I think he is.
Pulling push.
Wow.
Let's see. So if he would have just prepped the Tinker Roll there, how much damage would he have got in?
Tom is so far ahead right now, but if he keeps drawing spells and Vortex can somehow clear those minions, maybe there is a potential comeback. But it's looking pretty bleak right now, and especially with a defender draw. Not the card he wanted to see.
Both Void Terror and both the Defender of Arguses are just so reliant on you actually having things in play, and Edwin does not let any of the things stay in play.
There's even a backstop for them. For the juggler now.
And we still have Tink Royal in hand, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
That's a trick, not too bad.
And here we go.
Down to 8 HP.
This was the play I wouldn't even mind seeing the following turn, but it's way better to do it this turn.
Defender has to come down.
Yep, yes, another one too, but it's only a matter of time that Tom is gonna draw a Flurry.
Flurry or Sprint or...
Yeah, there's so many things. Yeah. The zoo won't be healing up. Getting close. No, wait, is that actually... Because he can eviscerate one of the taunts.
Yeah.
He can use the weapon on the second one. He didn't even need the Drake.
Just for show.
Yeah.
That's the game.
Wow.
Really close series once again.
Turning around two, I would say, unplayable matchups against Sue, and taking the match against Vortex. Really impressive
game,
play there by Tom.
That game four, I mean, Vortex's streams just exploded with the sheep.
Yeah. You know what? For the second major Hearthstone tournament in a row, an Asian player, in fact, the only Asian player in the tournament, has made it to the finals.
Very impressive. Okay.
Tom looking to follow in Tiddler Celestial's footsteps. I think Tom, he probably wants to come to get his winner's interview right now. So thank you, Orange.
Thanks a lot. It was lots of fun.
Tom, get in here. Hi, Tom. That was a really close series, right?
Yeah, and I'm really, really regret of the Rock versus Temple match. I just don't attack one turn. Yeah, so I lose that game.
Yeah,
we actually know that because you didn't. If you didn't kill the Mana Worm, you would have been dead. You would have lost the game still. So
not
that one.
Yeah, okay. The past turn, the like sixth turn.
Okay.
Yeah, I have one durability
weapon.
Oh,
I remember.
Oh, yeah.
The turn that was. You had a Violet Teacher in hand. Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah,
we
so
forgot about that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I really, really regret of it. Yeah.
When you were down 1-2, he had the Zoo left against two decks that I think Zoo might be even or slightly favored against. Were you worried at all?
You mean Lulak more favored than Warrior?
Zoo was favored. We thought Zoo was favored against Druid, and you also had the Rogue left.
my Jui doesn't really afraid of Lulac. I think I just search for the wild growth and innovate. I just don't keep the keeper or ref. It's not a win condition. I think Jui is about 50-50.
Certainly a very different way to play that matchup. Only searching, like digging hard for those two cards. Yeah. It's kind of like the mentality of like Warrior when you try to search for that Teferi War Axe as much as possible. Yeah. So, Tom, realize that, again, Tiddler won DreamHack recently.
Yeah.
He was the only one of the only Asian players at that tournament. Now you're the only Asian player at this tournament. Are you going to follow in his footsteps?
Yeah, I really, really hope. Yeah.
Well, we definitely hope you get that win. How do you think you'll match up against Powder?
I think it's pretty good because he has a double BGH Mali luck. Yeah. And my deck's not really big target for him to BGH. Yeah.
Yeah, well, we certainly wish you the best of luck in the finals.
Yeah.
I'm sure you want to prepare right now. Savit, do you have any final questions?
No, I just want to wish you good luck in the finals, and it's going to be an exciting one, I'm sure.
Thanks.
So 32 players right now. We've whittled down to two players, Powder versus Tom. We're going to take a very short 15-minute break, and right after that, we'll have the conclusion of the ASUS ROG Summer 2015 Hearthstone Tournament. See you then.